For those of you who are regulars, we are actually finishing off a series of Bible talks we've been working through the last few weeks, looking at the Old Testament book of Psalms, written hundreds of years before the time of Jesus. And it's fascinating as we've seen the way they all somehow seem to be pointing forward to Jesus, and especially so this morning as we come to Psalm 16. That's on page 542 of the Church Bibles, if you got one of those. Again, I believe we ran out of church Bibles this morning, so we are going to put the words up on the screen as well. Except, no, we're not, Bob, because something's gone wrong with that and we've lost the first bit of that. Nothing's going right today. It's one of those Sundays. But I believe Jesus was raised, so something went right. Let me read Psalm 16. And we might as well leave that there for when we get to verse 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Keep me safe, O God, it starts. It's a miktam of David, the little heading at the start, Psalm 16 on page 542. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Now, do hang on to your Bible. Keep it open there, because we're going to have a think about those words together. Let me pray before we do that. Heavenly Father, our prayer on this morning when Christians everywhere rejoice is that you will help us to pay attention to your word, that we would listen carefully to it, that we would understand it and be drawn to Jesus by it. We pray in his name. Amen. How long can a human being live? Now, I'm asking that first off as a scientific question because I read an article about it the other day which said the oldest person to ever live, recorded anyway, was a French woman, Jeanne Calment. She lived... Oh yes, there she is. She died actually in 1997 at the age of 122 years and 238 days. To put that in perspective, she died actually 101 years after she got married in 1896. She could remember meeting Vincent van Gogh, who she described as scruffy looking. She used to sell him coloured pencils in her dad's shop. Against the odds, as you have observed already in the picture, Jean was a regular smoker, like I think everyone else in France. She said that the secret of her long life was eating lots of olive oil, as well as rubbing it into her skin, which you might like to try when you get home later. But back to the scientific question, because statistically it seems nobody anywhere in any country, in any culture, no matter how good the medical care or how bad, nobody anywhere seems to have been able to crack Jean's record. There have been a few who have hit 120. Jean hit 122. But no more. Scientists say that seems to measurably be the upper limit to human life. Which makes then King David's words in Psalm 16 seem oddly over-optimistic. Did you notice that near the end of the psalm? Psalm 16 verse 9, you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. Now, those are the words of Israel's ancient king, appointed and anointed by God who seems to be saying, no matter what the realities of other world leaders, no matter what the reality of other ordinary people, people like you and me, that God wasn't going to let him go the way of ordinary mortality and die and rot away. You will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. Now, to make sense of that, let's step back and start at the beginning of the psalm again, this optimistic ancient poem, which from the outset you see is about King David's confidence in God. We're told in the very small print at the start of the psalm that it's a miktam of David. Nobody is actually sure what a miktam is, except that it's one of these. But one guess is miktam means an inscription, words to be engraved for posterity, sort of words you'd carve on a monument or a building, or maybe your gravestone or your tomb. David's miktam is spelling out where he finds his security, where he finds his hope for the future. And the point is, as we look at it, it's not a fortress, it's not with his army, his hope is not in a diet rich with olive oil. In the ESV translation, which is slightly more literal, verse 1 says, "Preserve me, O God." It's the same meaning. "Keep me safe, O God. In you I take refuge." Verse 2, "I said to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing." David says, apart from the Lord, he's got everything else is just a vain hope. And yet the issue is, when you come down to it, even with the Lord, if he's thinking somehow that trusting his God means he's going to avoid death and decay in the end, maybe he's being just a little bit too optimistic, don't you think? But let's keep moving, because in verses 3 to 6 there's a picture of what David sees as two very clear options: taking refuge in the Lord like he does, or like so many other Israelites, running after other gods instead. Because the thing with the Israelites, they always love to take an each-way bet. And so there's a shrine to the god Asherah just down the road with its poles where you can get drunk and dance around naked with the shrine prostitutes. And the upside is people say it guarantees good crops. Asherah is a fertility goddess. It's got to be a win-win, hasn't it? They're saying, what's the downside? Some wild naked dancing, have a lot of fun and good crops as well. So you'll be off sacrificing to Israel's God one day, and you'll be down the road dancing around Asherah poles the next. You'll be honouring the God of Israel one day and pouring out drink offerings of blood to Baal, the Canaanite god, on a Wednesday afternoon. To which David says, not for me. He says, my security, my crops, my everything else, it all comes from the Lord my God, and my delight, he says, is in my fellow Israelites who are faithful in the same way. Look at the contrast he draws in verses 3 and 4. As for the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I'll not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. You're not going to find me, says David, offering false sacrifices to false gods, because he says, I know where my good things come from. I know the source of every blessing. And look, it sounds at this point like every promise of blessing God has ever made to David has finally come about. He is a happy king. It's what he says in verse 5. Lord, you have assigned me my portion of my cup. You've made my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. Which is why, he says in verse 7 and 8, he praises the Lord day and night. And why in verse 9 his heart is glad and his tongue rejoices. As it is for most of us Australians most of the time, David looks around and says, well, life is pretty good. But unlike most Australians, David's confidence extends to the future as well. And it's not just his life insurance policy. So look carefully if you've got a Bible still open there. The middle of verse 9, there is a grammatical change of tense from the present, my heart is glad, to David's confidence for the future and what God will do. And it's at this point that he comes to the incredible claim we started out with. In a world where mortal bodies decayed exactly back then as they do these days. Aubrey de Grey is an American scientist who says he is going to cure ageing and vanquish death. It's a pretty big goal, I know, but he says the problem is, the key is the telomere, which is apparently the little kind of end cap on the end of our chromosomes, like the plastic bit on the end of a shoelace. Useful fact for trivia, that's called an aglet, by the way, on the end of a shoelace. You know, the little hard plastic bit. Well, genes have those as well. Chromosomes. And the problem is, he says, the telomere gets shorter every time your cells divide, and when it gets too short, the cells die. And Aubrey de Grey is researching an enzyme called telomerase, which he reckons can stop our telomeres, I hope I'm getting all these words right, getting shorter, stop them getting shorter, which ultimately, he says, might stop us ageing and dying, or on the other hand, might just cause terrible cancer. Now, most scientists think that he's crazy, but he is still trying. The technology guru, Ray Kurzweil, on the other hand, he works for Google. He's got another plan. By 2045, he says, you'll be able to upload your personality and your memories to a hard drive and live forever that way, on the Google Cloud. I guess the only downside is those annoying little ads that'll keep popping up all the time. And I'm not sure how it works. It might also be awkward having a beer with your mates. But in an each way bet, Ray Kurzweil says he's also going to have his body perfused with antifreeze and be stored in liquid nitrogen until future medical technology can revive him. Look, you see, death and decay, people are still desperately trying to beat it. And David apparently is convinced that he won't need the telomerase and he won't need the hard drive and he won't even need ice packs. David is apparently convinced that as the Holy One of God, as God's anointed one, as King of Israel, that his life, that his body is somehow going to be preserved forever and not going to be abandoned to the realm of the dead. Look again at his words on the screen. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices, and my body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. Which sounds, doesn't it, just as crazy as Ray Kurzweil or Aubrey de Grey without the technology to back it up. Or at the very least, it's an elevated idea of his own faithfulness, kind of, I'm so faithful, I'm going to live forever. You've got to admit that's a very big claim. And so is the last verse, verse 11. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. This faithful one, this king of men, is going to sit at the right hand of God. The obvious problem, of course, being that all this stuff was just so very easy to prove wrong. Because not so long after he wrote these words, King David got old and he died, and King David was buried in a tomb. And not to put too fine a point on it, King David's flesh was eaten by worms exactly like everybody else. Which makes words like, you will not let your faithful ones see decay, seem kind of hollow. You know, like the famous last words of the bomb disposal expert, I'm 100% sure it's the green wire. See, so confident, so easily proved wrong with one snip of the wire. At the very least, it's got to raise the question that if God really won't let his faithful ones see decay, well, then maybe David hasn't been all that faithful. Maybe David, in all his kingly glory, was just a shadow of what a real faithful one of God is meant to look like. And just maybe the role of everlasting ruler, the role of God's right-hand man who will never see decay, maybe if Israel wanted to keep dreaming of a king like that, the position's still vacant. It was waiting for someone more qualified. Whichever way you read it, it's got to be confusing to the average Jew reading the book of Psalms, reading Psalm 16 for hundreds and hundreds of years afterwards. Now, it's interesting because we'll see that's exactly the point where the New Testament picks up the words of exactly this ancient psalm in the first ever public Christian sermon. It's a sermon preached by the Apostle Peter in the book of Acts, chapter 2. Now, as I said, we've been working our way through a teaching series these last couple of months called Sing with Jesus. And we've been particularly looking at these Old Testament Psalms, which were sort of the songbook of the people of Israel that Jesus himself would have sung from. And we're picking up particularly the Old Testament Psalms that are then talked about later on in the New Testament, where over and over again they are read in the light of Jesus. And Peter's point in the first ever Christian sermon is exactly that, that David who wrote these words did not fulfill them. And his bones are still in the crypt. But Jesus, on the other hand, did fulfill them, and his grave is empty. At least that's the claim Peter makes. And he's persuaded by it. Now, if you've got a Bible and you're a fast flipper, you can turn over to Acts chapter 2, page 1092 in the church Bibles. Follow along. The main words will come up on the screen behind me, though. And we've got Peter here surrounded by a crowd of Jews in Jerusalem for a festival. And Peter has been remarkably somehow turned around by the Spirit of God. The guy who denied Jesus a few weeks before, now standing up and saying something radical's happened. The people are saying, what's going on? To which Peter says to them, it's all about Psalm 16. It's all about the Holy One of God, the faithful one. Not David, but this man Jesus who you crucified. And if you think the high hopes of Psalm 16 were fulfilled by your great King David, you're obviously wrong. It's Acts 2, verse 29. Look what he says in your Bible or up on the screen. He says, brothers, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. You can go and visit it, he says. But listen to this. Seeing what was ahead, he spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to the grave, nor did his body see decay. David was a disappointment, but his words were left hanging there, ready, waiting for the real Christ who was going to come. The one who, when he came, when he died, wouldn't be abandoned to the grave and wasn't. That is Peter's conviction. He was there and he saw it. Peter says, if you're looking for a good Christ test, if you want a way to recognise the real one, just watch what happens when he dies. It's a surefire method. Watch a while. See if he's abandoned to the grave or not. Check. See if he sees decay, because if he does, he's no Messiah. So Peter says, just listen for a minute to what we're saying about this Jesus of Nazareth. Listen for a minute to what we're saying about this crucified Galilean. Because the fact is, we have seen him back from the dead. Acts 2, verse 32. God has raised this Jesus to life, he says. And we're all witnesses of the fact. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. So he is the one to bow down to. He is the one God put his hand on, the one you crucified. God has given his full endorsement. See, Peter and James and John, those guys who saw Jesus back from the dead, they're not excited so much by the fact that it's a really odd thing to have seen someone dead and alive again. And they're not so much pumped by, you know, the nice kind of Easter Sunday messages you get in the newspaper editorials that say, isn't it nice that Christians believe you should never give up hope as you have another chocolate egg? I mean, that's true, and it is nice to know there's a reason for hope. But ultimately, Peter's saying that Psalm 16 and the resurrection of Jesus are not talking so much about how you might be able to face your death now with a new hope, but how you should live your life now, and more specifically, who the boss is. Which means, you see, Psalm 16 is not so much a nice psalm of comfort about you as it is a psalm that gets you ready to understand how great Jesus is. Because Peter says, if David thought it was all about him, then he failed. In the end, it's not. It's a psalm that says when a king comes along who beats crucifixion and defies the grave, when an imperishable king comes along who doesn't have a use-by date, when a king comes along who even beats the 122-year mark set by Jean Calment, then the thing to do is fall at his feet and say, you must be really, really important. You're the one. which, if you haven't got your Bible open and you run your eye down, you'll see is exactly what that first crowd of 3,000 Jews goes on to do as Peter winds up his sermon. Because if there is anyone worth bowing down to and putting at the centre of your universe, Peter says, it's got to be him. If there's anyone who can challenge your own ambitions and your goals and your drive to make yourself comfortable, your constant desire to make yourself number one, it can only be him. He qualifies. Let this be clear. Peter's claim here, in the light of the resurrection of Jesus, is that everything exists to serve Jesus. And on that message of the resurrection, the first church was born on that day. A bunch of committed followers of the risen Jesus of Nazareth, persuaded that he was indeed the one whose body did not see decay, and so the only reasonable thing to do is bow down to him, without reservation, without each-way bets. Now, if you are not a Christian today and you're visiting, can I say to you, just notice this, this is literally how we Christians got started. A bunch of people persuaded from Psalm 16 that Jesus qualifies as the holy and faithful one of God. And so this group of people started to define their lives by their allegiance to him instead of defining their lives by peer pressure or by greed or by the relentless ambition to suck as much out of life as you could before it was over. And so you are sitting, you see, if you're visiting, you're sitting today with a bunch of people who are giving it a shot at doing exactly that, exactly the same. We serve an imperishable king. That's the reminder every Easter Sunday, but it's actually what we're on about every other day as well, because we are persuaded that God did not let his Holy One see decay. It's given us a new way to look at death, but more than that, a new way to look at life as well. And if you're not there yet, you are very welcome to join us. Ben's going to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Dear Father, as we struggle in our own lives with the effects of death and decay, as we battle the realities of disease and doubt, as time takes its toll on our bodies and minds, even in the midst of this, we rejoice that Jesus is risen. We celebrate that King Jesus has left death and decay behind in the grave, raised to live and rule forever. Father, as we find comfort in the fact that death has been defeated, and in your promises that we can share in this victory, even in this comfort, remind us that we owe all our allegiance to Jesus, that our new life has been bought at the cost of his crucifixion and death, that we've been freed from the sentence of sin and all its accompanying guilt, that we've been freed not to serve ourselves, but to live lives of thankful obedience and service to him, to our risen King Jesus, with whom we will one day share eternal life. So please give us again this morning the joy and peace and confidence which comes from being united with Christ in his death and in his resurrection, and finding the true meaning in life in serving him. For his sake we pray. Amen.